So ultimately, we are saying that SOX 9 is produced, right? Now, SOX 9 is an autosomal gene, right? It's not on the sex chromosome. And it's actually, SOX 9 is actually a testis determining gene. So, what is the function of SRY? SRY protein activate SOX9 transcription, right? Now, SRY protein is produced by the SRY gene is activated, right? So SRY gene is not activated throughout. So SRY gene is activated only for 2 hours in testicular development. So it's active just for 2 hours and immediately start production of SOX9. So therefore, SRY is just a molecular switch, and that switch says on the process. Now, so SOX9 is critical. So there are people who are XX, but they are male. They are male because they have an extra copy of SOX9. That's why they are male. Now, SOX9 is actually a really older enzyme, very old enzyme. Older means, if I say older, means the evolutionary term. It's very, you know, old enzyme. So anywhere where a male is formed, SOX9 is activated, okay? So for example, in mammals, SRY activates SOX9, and then you become male. Whereas when you talk about in frog, fishes, birds, remember in bird they don't have Y chromosome like this, as we have ZZ and ZW, right? Where the ZZ was male, we did talk about in the birds. Now in that case, there is a transcription factor called, excuse me, DMRT1. So this is a transcription factor. This transcription factor activate SOX9 and you get male. We did talk about temperature dependent sex determination. In those cases, a specific temperature activate SOX9 and you become male. So SOX9 is the real gene which is telling you that you can be male or a female. Now, so what is happening, what SOX9 does? So SOX9, number one, it activates its own promoter. So kind of a feedback loop, activates own promoter. And then what it does, it blocks beta-catenin. So beta catenin blocks means no ovary, therefore no ovary. And then what it does, it binds to cis regulatory elements of the genes for various transcription factors. And those transcription factors are involved in testis formation. You know what are cis and trans regulatory element, right?
Well, can you say it again?
What are cis and trans regulatory elements?
Yes.
Cis and like the molecular structure, we know cis and trans.
What is cis? What molecular structure?
Cis is on the same.
Yeah, like
cis, and then trans.
Cis molecules have like two things on the same, and trans are like multiple.
That's
what
they're
no, you're talking about stuff.
I know.
That's
Gower's.
How you
about?
Isn't
about.
It like
okay.
Where it is on the gene? Like if it's connected to the gene or if it's.
Yeah, so cis regulatory elements are the part of the gene itself. Okay, you can have an enhancer, you can have suppressor, even the promoter region is also a cis regulatory element. So when you say it binds to cis regulatory element of gene for transcription factor, that means this is binding to the area on the gene where when it binds, it activates the transcription of the gene. And so cis regulatory element are component of the gene. When you talk about trans regulatory elements are usually the proteins which bind to the cis regulatory element of the proteins. So transcription factor are kind of trans regulatory molecules. Okay? So it's not molecular cis and trans. Yeah.
Does that mean that SOX9 itself is a trans?
No, yeah, it becomes trans because once it becomes protein, it's a trans regulatory molecule, right?
Yeah.
Transcription factors, so they are all like that. Okay. Now, so what else it does? It binds to the promoter of anti-Müllerian hormone gene. So it binds to promoter, that means it's acting as a transcription factor there, right? So it's activate anti-Müllerian hormone. Now, it promotes expression of fibroblast growth factor 9, FGF9. Now, FGF9 is actually critical, is critical for testis development. It's critical for testis development. Not only that, FGF9 actually stimulates production of SOX9. So what we are saying? We are saying that SOX9 is an autosomal gene that is required for testis formation. So it's the gene that is required for the male characteristics. And we are saying that SRY gene is only active for a few hours, 2 hours we said, and that acts as a molecule switch to start the SOX9 production. So SOX9 is so powerful, like even the XX invisible can be male if they have an extra copy of SOX9. Now SOX9, what it does, SOX9 essentially activates on promoters, so more and more SOX9 is made once it's active. It blocks beta catenin, that means stops the ovary formation pathway. Then SOX9 act, it binds to cis regulatory element of various transcription factor genes, so those transcription factors are required for the formation of the testes. It binds to promoter of anti-Müllerian hormone, so that anti-Müllerian hormone can be produced and the Müllerian duct is degenerated. And then it promotes the production of FGF9, and FGF9 is critical for testis development. And then FGF9 can further stimulate production of SOX9, and this process can keep on going. Making sense? So talk to each other for a minute, then we'll go further.
So is SOX9 binding to SRY or SRY?
No, SRY produce SOX9.
Well, we talked earlier about how SRY binds to the cis
enhancer. SRY binds to the promoter of the SOX9 so that SOX9 can be produced.
Gotcha.
Okay. Right? So SRY is a transcription factor, you can say that, that binds to promoter of SOX9, so that SOX9 is made. Any other doubt or question? Okay. You're okay, William?
Yep.
Okay, now. Then we are saying, so we are kind of going like SRY, we did talk about SRY, then we said it does SOX9. We talked about what SOX9 does, right? But now we are saying SOX9 make FGF9, right? So what is FGF9 doing? So fibroblasts growth factor 9 or FGF9. So if you knock out FGF9, if you knock out FGF9, that results in all female. Okay, so now what FGF9 is activated by a SOX9, right? So what FGF9 does? So we are saying, when we started yesterday, we said when the germ cell enter into the developing gonad, if it is XY, then the mesodermal cell divide, and they change into Sertoli cell. And then we are saying Sertoli cell proliferate. Remember what Sertoli cell were doing? Sertoli cell were making anti-Müllerian hormone. So If they are not there, then anti-Müllerian hormone will not be produced. You will have the oviduct formation and everything, right? So FGF9, what it does, it induces the proliferation of Sertoli cells. So Sertoli cells are made in large number because of the FGF9. Now, they were mesenchyme first, right? They divide, then they should actually also differentiate into the cell like Sertoli cell, right? So it induced the proliferation of Sertoli cell and induced differentiation of Sertoli cells. So they can work like Sertoli cells, that's what it does. Now, the other thing it does is it activates migration of blood vessels from kidney to the developing testes, therefore form major arteries of testes. So, testes blood vessel system is made by FGF9. The other thing it does is it induces, it play a role to change Sertoli cells so that they can form testis cords. So all the testis cords which are formed that are done by this. Now, the other thing it does is, so the testes had now mesenchyme cell, those mesenchyme cells become Sertoli cell, but we said that is everything is regulated by SOX9. And we said SOX9 make FGF9, FGF9 make back SOX9, right? So now when they have become Sertoli cell, at that time what FGF9 does, FGF9 induces SOX9 production in Sertoli cells. So they are making Sertoli cells start making SOX9, SOX9 making FGF9, so that loop is continuously acting. And then what it does is, number 5, FGF9 blocks Wnt4. Remember, Wnt4 and R-spondin together were making beta-catenin, right? So far we are saying beta-catenin is blocked. This is how it is blocked. Because Wnt4 is not there, R-spondin-1 cannot do anything on its own. So beta-catenin, therefore, beta-catenin blocked. So beta-catenin pathway is blocked. Now, most important thing when we started this thing, we started about gametogenesis, right? We said that in the female, oogonia immediately start meiosis. But spermatogonia type A1 spermatogonia, they do not go meiosis. Meiosis occur only at puberty, right? So what caused that inhibition is the FGF9. So number 6, FGF9 inhibit meiosis of germ cells in developing testes. So what we are saying, hey, this, the FGF which is produced by SOX9 is critical for the development of male. If you knock down SOX9, you will have all female. The reason is very clear, what FGF9 is doing. FGF9 is blocking Wnt4. So if FGF9 is not there, Wnt4 will be there, R-spondin-1 will be there, you will have beta-catenin activation and all female. Making sense? Then what it does, it induces the proliferation of Sertoli cells. So you have more Sertoli cells, and then Sertoli cells can do everything in the testes. They make antimullerian hormone, right? And again, antimullerian hormone is activated by SOX9, so you need SOX9 there. So then we are saying what FGF9 does, it basically induces Sertoli cell to produce SOX9 cell, so make more SOX9 in the Sertoli cell. Then what it does, it causes migration of blood vessels to the developing testes, so nearby kidney is developing. So It basically attracts the blood vessels from the kidney to the testes. So those blood vessels actually form the blood vascular system of the testes. And then it induces the Sertoli cells to form testis cords. So in this way, FGF9 is regulating how the male gonad is formed. Making sense? Okay, so talk to each other for a minute, then we'll go further. Any question? Okay, now. In the beginning, we said there are four transcription factors which are already present. We said SF1, WT1, GATA4, and LHX9, right? We said those four transcription factors present there, they are critical. They are critical, but as the progression of the development of either testes or ovaries start, these transcription factors, their levels start going down, except SF1. So SF1 is actually a critical link, between SRY and male development. So SF1 is necessary for the bipotential gonad. So if XX. At that time, what happened? The level of SF1 goes down. So its level goes down. But if XY, if it is XY, what happened? The level of SF1 remains high. In the developing testes, so what it does? So why this level is high here? Why the level goes down here? In the Y chromosomes, there is SRY, right? So the SRY gene or SRY protein maintain high SF1 levels. That's why its levels are high there. Now, so what is, why it is so critical? What it does, SF1 collaborate with SRY to increase SOX9 levels in Sertoli cells. So SRY can induce the SOX9, but SF1 make it higher induction. And that is what is required there, right? So you need more and more SOX9. And the second thing what it does is, so we are saying, we did talk about anti-mullerian hormone production. We said that SOX9 induces anti-mullerian hormone production, right? But the testosterone is also produced that make the mesonephros and nephric duct into epididymis and vessa deferens, right? So what induces the level of testosterone? What induces testosterone production? So SF1 actually binds to promoter of testosterone in leading cells to produce testosterone. Okay, so what we have talked so far overall, we are saying the genetic control is depending upon the four transcription factors, SF1, WT1, LH69, and GATA4. And we are saying those four transcription factors are critical for this bipotential gonad. Then we said if it is a female gonad, then you should have WNT4 production and you should have R-spondin. Both R-spondin and WNT4 activate Dishy-Weird and basically maintain the beta-catenin signal. Once you have beta-catenin signal there, you are not going to have any of the SOX9 production. If there is no SOX9 production, beta-catenin is going to activate ovary-specific gene and you will have the ovary. Then we are saying if it is XY, then you have this SRY present there, and SRY gene product is critical because SRY gene product can activate, it does activate the production of SOX9. SOX9 is critical because SOX9 produces FGF9. And then SOX9 also activates anti-mullerian hormone production. Then we say FGF9 is critical because FGF9 maintains SOX9 level. FGF9 induces production of SOX9 in Sertoli cell. FGF9 tells Sertoli cell to make testis coat. And FGF9 also further activates SOX9. Then we are saying all the initial four transcription factors, they go down if it is XX. But if it is XY, SF1 level remains high, and that remains high because SRY induces the production of SF1. SF1 along with SRY is responsible for production of SOX9, especially in the Sertoli cell. Now we are saying that SF1 is responsible to go in leading cell and bind to the transcription factor of testosterone, so the testosterone is high and you can have epididymis and vessa deferens formation. That was all about genetic control. This is okay so far? Any doubts? So talk to each other for a minute, then we'll go further. Any doubt? You guys are okay? Okay now. But having said all the genetic control, but there is one thing which is most important, and that is the right time, and the right place. So having right gene, having correct gene, doesn't mean that you will get the organ which you are expecting for. So then what is critical here? In this particular case, any delay in SRY expression or production of SRY protein below threshold, below the threshold. There should be a threshold level. You should have that much protein that can actually bind to the promoters of SOX9 and activate enough SOX9. There's so many SOX9 there, right? So many genes should be there. You need to activate all those instantaneously. Even if you have XY, but if you have delay in the expression or you don't produce enough, then what is happening by the time SOX9 is activated, gonad is already on the path of ovary development. It's a way you cannot miss the bus if you want to go somewhere, right? So you're already becoming ovary. So there is a brief window. In that brief window, the SRY must be activated. Otherwise, you're not going to get the testes. You're going to get the ovary. Again, the female is a default path. So you're going on that path if you're not doing it. Now, you can have, this is kind of more elaborating what you were talking yesterday. You can have hermaphrodites. So hermaphrodites are individuals with both testes and ovary. So they can have two stages. One stage is what we call, they can have ovotestes. Ovotestes means a gonad looking like ovary and looking like testes, looking like both. Or they can be conditioned that they can have one testes or they can have one ovary. That can happen. Now, that is happening only when SRY gene is activated later. If SRY gene is late, then activating at the normal time, so I'll say later than normal time. If it is activated later than normal time, so even say two rudiments of the gonads are developing, and one rudiment activate normal time, that become testes. And one rudiment activate later, that become ovary. Or it can happen that it's not sufficiently produced, so its protein is not sufficiently spread out throughout. So what is going to happen? The part where the protein is more, that part is going to become testes. The other part where there's not much protein that is become ovary. That's why you have ovotestes. Making sense? So those conditions can occur. So the timing is critical. Now, in some cases, we can have, that is rare actually, we can have mosaic cells. Remember, all of us are coming from XY, XYXX, right? So XY coming from a father, XX coming from the mother. So you can have condition in the early development that you can have a XX here, but somehow the translocation has occurred, so you have a SRY portion here. Right? Or, so if you have SRY here, you're going to become the male, although you're XX, but the translocation has taken place, if the cell is like that. But in the other cell, you might have a condition, you might have XY here, but this SRY is exchanged with this motion of X there, right? So then you will have a female cell. So you can have such kind of mosaic cell also, but that's very rare. That's not that common. That can also happen. So in that cases also, you will have kind of a weird overtesis-like situation. So we are saying like having the gene doesn't mean anything. It's meaningful only if the gene is activated at the right time. And it's activated enough to produce enough protein to actually perform its function. Ultimately, it's proteins, right? We always talk about proteins are doing everything. So if the SRY production is delayed, the beta-catenin pathway will be active and you are going to form the ovaries. And we are saying in hermaphrodite, you can have a condition where you can have ovotestis. An organ can look both like ovary and testis, or you can have person with one testis and one ovary. And those conditions can happen because SRY is activated later than the normal time. Or it has not produced enough protein uniformly throughout the development testis or developing ovary, whatever it is. Making sense? Okay, so talk to each other and then we will go further. Because you will have some cell acting as male, some cell acting as female, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you will get the ovotestis from there. Any other? Okay. So now we are on the secondary sex determination in mammals. That is more about the phenotype, right? So what happened, there is hormonal regulation of sexual phenotypes. So if you are a male, so what is happening in male? In the male, you are producing androgens. Okay. So androgens are testosterone, and dihydrotestosterone. These are the hormone you are producing, and then you should have actually androgen receptors. Okay. Now, if you have this, now here the situation has become more interesting. What happens if you have this, you actually block production of Wnt inhibitors. And we know that one of them is what they call receptor sticky and all those things, what they are, we're having them sticky, cerebral stick off, right? So you inhibit that. Production of Wnt inhibitors. Remember in the beginning when we're talking about the testes and ovary, we're saying Wnt activation is going to give you beta catenin, and that is going to make the ovary, right? Now the situation is reversed. Therefore, Wnt beta catenin pathway this is not on, right? And if it's this on, what you get male phenotype. So that means that having the beta catenin activity to make you a ovary has nothing to do with the appearance. Because there we said the beta catenin activity is going to give you the ovary. But here we are saying when you get the phenotype. Remember, we should this is interesting, like when you're talking about this, we should not talk about one organ. We are now talking about the body. So here the player have reversed their roles. Now if you are a female, in the female, no androgen, therefore you get production of Wnt inhibitors, and then when you get that, you get a female phenotype. Because here the Wnt beta catenin pathway is off. And it's off, then you get female phenotype. And you might have heard of the one of the therapy for the prostate cancer is they are trying to give them Wnt inhibitors. So they want this process to shut off to treat the prostate cancer. And that is true for testicular cancers also. Once the development passes, everything changes. Making sense so far? So we are saying testosterone, hydrotestosterone, and their receptor, once that pathway is activated, that block the production of Wnt inhibitor. And that allow Wnt beta catenin pathways to active. When that happens, you get male phenotype. In the females, you don't have this system, so Wnt inhibitors are produced, and when they are produced, they block Wnt beta catenin pathway, and when that pathway is blocked, you get the female phenotype. That is making sense? Now, here is something more interesting, which I'm just talk about this, and we'll talk a little bit more interesting thing here. Yes. Remember, gonads are one part of the body developing.
Yes.
But then the body is developing separately. If you separate gonad from the rest of the body.
Okay.
So think about, you know, that's why we are saying like a person can have a male gonad, female gonad both, right? Mm-hmm. But still, person may look like a male or look like a female. They depend upon this then. So gonad development is okay, that's part of the sexual development. But gonad development doesn't have to look at the physical appearance, and that's what I'm going to talk in a minute. Any question here? Okay, now. So we are saying a separate AMH. AMH is anti-mullerian hormone. Okay? And testosterone pathway adjust for masculinity. Now, this is going to clear what I was just talking about, okay? So we are saying that there is a syndrome, actually. That syndrome is called androgen insensitivity syndrome. So these people make testosterone. They make testosterone or hydrotestosterone, right? But they lack functional testosterone receptors. So they don't have testosterone receptors. And think that this person, of course, when testosterone is produced in the male, right? So this should be XY people. So their leading cell are producing FCF9 is produced, SRY making FCF9 produced, SOX9, FCF9, leading cell are making testosterone, right? So they have testosterone, but these people lack functional testosterone receptor. Now, all of us have adrenal glands, okay? From adrenal gland, adrenal glands actually make estrogen. So all male and female, they are exposed to estrogen. It's not like only female are exposed to estrogen. But because we have too much testosterone, we override that signaling, the estrogen signaling. Now, these individuals, now they are responding to the estrogen, okay? And what happened? This individual will have testes. Now, this individual will be, but those testes will be abdominal. Those tests will be abdominal, okay, like the ovaries are abdominal. And then this individual will they have oviduct and uterus? They should not have oviduct and uterus because they are XY, right? So why should activate SRY? SRY should activate SOX9. SOX9 should go to cytosine, activate anti-mullerian hormone. No mullerian duct, right? So that means no oviduct or uterus. But phenotypically, they are females. So that means they will be female. But since they don't have any oviduct or ovary or uterus, they are sterile female. So that tells us, like, there are two pathways. One pathway is, we wrote here anti-mullerian hormone pathway. Anti-mullerian hormone pathway means this is the genetic pathway because AMH is activated by SOX9, right? That pathway is the developmental pathway. which is happening for the development of gonads. But that pathway is different from the phenotypic appearance, and that's why we said like there's contrast between how the pathways are activated there.
So when they're born, would they know that they're
like males? They were born like females.
So they wouldn't know they were males until puberty?
You will never know they are male.
Oh, they never know?
You will never know. Unless until you say, hey, why this female is sterile? And you go to doctor and test, hey, not having baby. Then you realize, oh, this is what is happening.
Oh, I was going to say, they don't have any receptors for androgens. So I was going to say,
no, you should have testosterone to more stronger, right?
Yeah.
That's what people do, the androgen. They will be like, normal female don't have testosterone.
Yeah.
But they're stronger, they're not weak. Right? You don't need only testosterone to be stronger.
Yeah.
Well, they go through puberty
as well as one thing? They will not go puberty as such because they don't have ovaries, they have testes. But remember, you might have heard of these hormone replacement therapies, like people are male or becoming female, and female are becoming male. That's all the hormone, right? They're not going to change the gene. These hormones and beta-catenin pathway, when you want to activate or deactivate those. Question? Okay, so we are done with this.
Oh, shit.
Okay, so we'll meet on Friday, and then idea, evaluation.
You did
it.
I did it.
Oh, you did it?
I was the last one. I did it last night.
Okay, everyone
did
it. Okay. Okay, that's good.